and you're out there saving people's lives, I don't think they're going to be like, oh.
Hold on, player. Hold on.
What's up, you guys? It's Adanna. I am back with another video for you guys. I tried to do that like the let's get ready to rumble guy, you guys.
Let's get ready to rumble!
But it's not quite working, so I'm going to just stick with my PA Q&A Tuesday. All right, so that is what we're doing today. I am reading you guys' questions and answering them. So if you haven't already done so, go ahead and leave your comments or your questions in the comment section below for the next PA Q&A Tuesday, because I usually get my comments that I'm actually answering from these videos, okay? Also, is there a competitiveness in your class in the sense that everyone is always trying to, trying to top everyone else? If so, how do you deal with it? Okay, so is there a competitiveness in my class? No. So my class, like, they kind of talked about this from the jump. Like, as soon as we got into PA school, they were like, look, you guys are like a team, you're a family, you're a cohort. We want you guys to kind of matriculate together. Therefore, do not talk about your grades. Do not talk about your scores. If you have friends and you're like, oh, how'd you do? Did you do well? Great, cool. You keep it moving. If not, you know, like, is there anything that we can do to help out? No, great. Keep it moving. That kind of thing. It's kind of just like up in the air. No one ever knows anyone's grades. Like there are times when we know, like, oh, if they're like, yeah, somebody got 100 or something like that, how we found out, I have no idea. But if we do, we don't necessarily know who it is, or they'll kind of give a range at times. They'll say, okay, so the top score was 90 this, the average was this. They never say what the lowest score was, which is a blessing for anybody that may have gotten a low score, well below the average. You don't necessarily want to feel, you know, any like incompetence or anything like that. But no, there's no competitiveness. We're really, really, our class shares everything with respect to all of the study guides that they have. It's all in one Google Drive so that we can have access to it if we want to use the study guides made by other students in the class or the class prior to us. They shared their study guides with us as well, which was very beneficial throughout the majority of didactic year thus far. So they're really, really helpful in that sense, and no one really talks about their grades, so there's no true competitiveness at all. I have two questions. One, I already graduated high school. I'm currently attending community college for AAT in kinesiology. Would I still be able to apply for a bridge program? And two, are there any majors/degrees that PA programs frown upon for being too easy, or it doesn't really matter as long as you meet all the requirements? Thanks in advance. So question number one, your associates in kinesiology, are you able to apply to a bridge program? So I know that with respect to Howard, when Howard was doing their PA program, like, there was an option for you to still apply to the bridge program if you were going straight into the master's, I guess you could say. So it's not really a bridge program, but you could go, if you already had your bachelor's degree, you could go into the master's, which you could already do. So no, so I don't know. I don't know how that works. From my understanding, the bridge program is just a matter of you are coming straight out of high school, you're applying to their undergraduate degree. It's gonna give you the PA degree in 5 years or 6 years, which typically you do anyways, because you're spending 4 years at an undergraduate degree and then 2 years in your master's. If it's 5 years, you're getting out a little bit sooner. But I don't know how that associate's degree would work. If you already have an associate's degree, I feel like you're better off just going the other 2 years to get your bachelor's degree and then get into a master's program for PA school. You know, you don't want to waste those 2 years that you've already done in your associate's degree for kinesiology. So that would be my suggestion. But if you are looking into any specific school, please go ahead, talk to the school, ask them, and I'm pretty sure they'll be more than happy to answer that question for you. As far as, is there any degree that is frowned upon? I mean, I don't know. I'm not an admissions director at schools. I don't know if schools are looking at the degrees like, oh, you have a degree in fine arts, you're not going to be a good PA. They're more so, from my understanding, looking at the prerequisite courses. How well did you do in those prerequisite courses? And then your actual healthcare and patient care experience. So were you an EMT for 5 years? I don't think if you had a degree in fine arts or music appreciation, not to say that those are easy, but I'm just trying to think of something that's not science-based. But if you had something, you know, had a degree in that, and then you were an EMT for 3 years or a firefighter for 5 years, and you're out there saving people's lives, I don't think they're going to be like, oh,
hold on, player. Hold on.
You got a degree in fine arts. You're not going to be you're not a good candidate. I'm looking down on that. No, it's really with respect to your experience. There are a lot of things, I mean, and I think you guys will just, maybe some of you have already realized this, but and if you haven't, you will find this out, that in life, a lot of times, it's all about your experience. It's about your experience and who you know. That is what's going to get you in. That's what's going to get you the jobs, that kind of thing. And so with respect to PA school and anything in general, it's about your experience. Sometimes experience trumps your degrees. So just keep that in mind, but I don't really think that anything is looked down upon. But again, if you are concerned, ask whatever schools that you are applying to or that you're thinking of applying to, hey, are there any degrees that you guys don't really accept so that I'm not wasting my time and money in applying to your school? What's the best way to study as far as organization methods? All right, so for me, I study various different ways for different classes. I use a lot of study guides. We make our own study guides, or we kind of augment the study guides that we've gotten from previous classes with what we've gotten in lecture, and then I study off of that. I like to study by myself and make sure that I get the material down myself before I kind of break out into a group if I so choose to go study with a group, but that's for me. With respect to my pharmacology class, I know I've showed you guys this before, but I use bubble maps or mind maps, however you guys want to call them, to actually study for that so that I will have like the drug class, their adverse effects, their mechanism of action, you know, their generic name, that kind of stuff, all in little bubbles that are kind of attached to each other, because seeing it is easy for me. There are students that use Excel spreadsheets and that works great for them, but for me, I can't just do the straight memorization with Excel spreadsheets. When I'm in my pharmacology test, I literally see those maps in my head. I'm like, okay, so I remember seeing this. I may not necessarily remember exactly what I had written there, but I know like it's up in the right-hand corner, and in the right-hand corner was my barbiturates. So what are my adverse effects? That kind of thing. And that helps me with respect to positioning and understanding what exactly that particular drug might be. So for me, with respect to farm, I use maps. With respect to my med practice and my physical diagnosis class, I use just study guides. And I organize them from slides or from particular diseases. So like, let's say we're in peds right now, and there are like medical emergencies. All of the medical emergencies or pediatric medical emergencies are in one block. And then all of the pulmonary or respiratory diseases are in another. And that just makes it easy for me. I can break it down. I can group them together, and any little stupid mnemonic that I can come up with, that works. So those are just some options for you. I don't think it just works for PA school. I think it can work for any school, undergrad, high school, wherever you're at in your schooling career. What is the average age of a PA student? The average age of a PA student is 27. So obviously there are students that are older and younger. If you haven't seen my How Old is Too Old for PA School video, go ahead. I'm gonna leave a link for that. I've done a video, and then I've also done a true life series. If you haven't seen my true life series, go ahead and check that out. I have a playlist of that, so you guys can check that out as well. But it talks about people and being old, or you know, thinking that you're old, and you know, there are people that are well above 27, and then there are people that are like slightly above 27, but For the most part, the average age is 27. There are not that many students that come straight out of undergrad and go into PA school, but there are some that do. I think just in my class alone, I think there was like maybe three or four of them out of 30. So, you know, that's a pretty high percentage, but for the most part, everyone has already kind of been either in their first career and this is now their second career, or they've been working towards becoming a PA. But the average age is 27. All right, so that is another one in the books for you guys. If you have any further questions that you want answered on the next PA Q&A Tuesday, leave that in the comment section below. I will be sure to get to them and answer them. Thank you guys so much for watching. And if you haven't already done so, go ahead and follow me on Instagram at Adanna the PA and like this video. Like it right now, like this video. All right, I will talk to you guys next time. Bye.